tendency is to use the rental income to pay the rental expenses. It just makes sense. But there is a better way to manage our cash flows. What we're going to do is use the rental income to pay off our non-deductible mortgage first, because we don't get any tax benefits for carrying that mortgage. It's bad debt, so let's get rid of it. The first step, we make our regular mortgage payment, same as before, and we make an additional prepayment to the value of the monthly rent. The principal portion of our regular mortgage payment plus the full value of the prepayment goes directly to pay down our mortgage balance, and the equity becomes immediately available in the investment line of credit, which we then draw to cover the rental expenses and run our landlord business. That's it. Every single month we use the rental income to prepay our mortgage and borrow funds to cover the rental expenses. That is cash down. All right, so let's run through a quick case study. In this scenario, the homeowner has a $500,000 mortgage on their principal residence. They use the mortgage to buy the home, so they're not currently getting any tax benefits from this debt. They're on a 30-year amortization, 5.45%, which means their monthly mortgage payment is $2,804. Their marginal tax bracket is 40%, which means that for any debt they convert to a tax-deductible investment loan, they'll end up getting 40% of the interest back every year at tax time. The rental property is worth $500,000. It has a mortgage on it with a balance of $375,000. So there's $125,000 in equity, and the total annual cost to run the property is $33,000, $2,753 per month to be precise. The expenses include $25,000 for mortgage payments, $5,400 for maintenance and condo fees and insurance, and $2,400 for property taxes. In a moment, we're going to explore a few different scenarios for each one. The principal residence, the rental property, and the homeowner's financial profile will remain exactly the same as displayed on the screen. So going back to our cash flow cycle. Okay, so this time we're using the numbers from our example. We've got our principal residence in the center, and we're making our regular mortgage payments of $2,804. The payment comes from the homeowner's regular household bank account, same as it does today, no change. Up above, we've got the rental property income on the left, expenses on the right. We receive just over $33,000 in rental income annually on the property. That's $2,753 each month that we can use to prepay our mortgage and drive the non-deductible debt to the ground. From there, we use the funds to make all the payments into the rental property. That's the cycle. Every month, we get our rental income, we run it through the primary residence, and we convert bad debt over to the tax-deductible side of the balance sheet and draw the funds to pay our rental expenses. So what does this do? Here are the financials for the scenario where the homeowner already owns the rental property and does not need to borrow the down payment. For the first thing we look at is how long it takes to move the full balance of the mortgage over to the investment line. We call this debt conversion, and depending on how many properties there are, it can typically take 6 to 12 years. In this case, debt conversion takes place in year 9. So this means that all of the non-deductible mortgage has been moved over to the investment line of credit. This doesn't mean the mortgage is paid off, it just means we've reached a point where the debt is completely tax deductible and we're receiving our maximum annual tax refunds. The next thing we look at is the total value of the refunds earned in the plan. This assumes the rate of interest is constant and the marginal tax rate doesn't change either. In reality, these things can fluctuate, but it does give us a sense of the total amount of tax refunds we can expect to achieve in this strategy. In this case, the homeowner receives $117,000 in refunds over the life of the mortgage. Technically, the homeowner can do whatever they want with these refunds. They can save the money or spend it, but when we do projections like this, we like to assume the homeowner is going to use the refunds to pay the mortgage down faster. In this example, the net effect of using the tax refunds to accelerate the plan is they're able to pay off their mortgage 97 months ahead of schedule. which saves them $272,000. Taking into account that we make our mortgage payments with after-tax earnings, we can calculate the level of income required to make those payments. At a 40% marginal tax rate, we would need to earn $453,000 to make those 97 payments. That's close to $500,000 of income savings that can go towards more important things and possibly help the homeowner retire many years ahead of schedule. Technically, the homeowner is mortgage-free 97 payments sooner than they otherwise would be, and in order to provide an apples-to-apples comparison, we assume they continue making payments and reinvest those 97 payments to the end of their original amortization so that they can earn a rate of return for the future savings. The calculator allows us to play with the different growth rate assumptions, and for this scenario, we are using 6%, which results in a future value of the invested payment savings of $348,969. We also calculate the future value of the rental, which is now $1.2 million. There is no outstanding liabilities, no mortgage, no home equity line of credit, and the rental mortgage is paid in full. And finally, we see the net wealth improvement, $348,000, which is essentially the future value of those 97 payment savings at that 6% growth rate. It's worth noting that our calculator allows us to include or exclude the rental property depending on the circumstance. If we had used the strategy to purchase the rental property, we would include that in your net income. In this case, because the homeowner already owned the rental property and would have benefited from the value appreciation, with or without the strategy, we're not including it, but still, $348,000, not too bad at all. So that is a lot of math and a lot of stuff I just threw at you guys. If anyone wants to connect with me and they have a scenario that they would like to run by me, this is my QR code. It has a link to my phone number, website, and if you're looking for to watch basically this presentation again on YouTube, you can also find it through this QR code. I'll allow everyone a few seconds to take the picture. And then questions about rental cash stamming.
Is it similar to Smith Maneuver Method?
It is exactly the Smith Maneuver Method, except in the Smith Maneuver Method, you can use the strategy to invest in stocks and different investments as well. Rental cash stamming specifically focuses on real estate because who doesn't love buying more real estate? But yes, it is the Smith Maneuver. So if you have the mortgage structure set up ahead of time, then you wouldn't need to go through a refinance. If you don't have the correct structure in place, then yes, we would do a refinance and set you up with a mortgage that had that auto readvanceable line of credit. Good question. Jimmy.
Okay, so this is a beginning expression. I have no rentals yet. I want to get into it. I have a house that is 7 years old. I got some money saved up so far.
You're lucky.
Yeah. I want to get into it, but if there's any way that I don't have to pull my house, or if you are in my shoes, what's the best way to do it without pulling any money off my pocket?
There's a few different ways you could go about it, Jimmy. One way that you could go about it is if you own a primary residence right now and you have funds ready and available to invest, you can make a prepayment on your mortgage, and then when we do a refinance, we'll open up your home equity line of credit, we'll then use that line of credit to purchase the rental property. Now you're getting a tax deduction from the investment line of credit from that original money that you've saved. The other way that you can go about it is you can buy the rental property with the money that you've saved, and then we can start implementing the strategy once you have the readvanceable line of credit set up on your primary residence. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So a few different ways you can go about them. Questions, any more?
We have the same question. We have the same question.
You want just to be the re-answer? Yes, go ahead.
My next question would be, let's say you're using that strategy, right? but then your debt will be technically be in the HELOC over time.
Correct.
So whatever you're saving in the taxes, like how do you pay that HELOC? Are you recommending the owners to use their savings from the taxes to pay off that HELOC?
Mm-hmm. Really good question. And so you're really thinking into it, and I really love that. And the benefit of this is that the strategy itself covers that payment. If we go back to this, the top one is our regular mortgage payment. And so every time you make a regular mortgage payment on your house, there's going to be a principal portion and an interest portion. And so when we pay down our mortgage on the readvanceable line of credit, the amount of principal that's paid down opens up. And the way mortgages are structured, you pay the most at the beginning and the least at the end. And in most cases, the strategy allows you that the amount that's being paid down on principal is servicing the home equity line of credit. And so the amount that we're paying down is being pulled into our rental account, and then we're going back after, and that's servicing the home equity line of credit.
Okay. So let's say in the end, I paid off my primary home, and I have a $500,000 that has freed up in my HELOC now, right? So
correct.
I can use that to reinvest in other properties, right? Can I do that strategy?
If I'm understanding what so yes, if you open up room that's not taken up by using the strategy, you can absolutely use that to reinvest in other properties. I'll touch on something because I think it's something that other people wonder about as well, is Ron, I convert my $500,000 into tax deduction, but now I'm still left with this $500,000 home equity line of credit. What am I doing with this? In our calculations, we run it that you pay the strategy or the home equity line of credit off. So in our example, it took us 9 years to convert the non-deductible debt into tax deductible debt. From there, all of the rental income can go towards servicing that home equity line of credit and getting it paid off, so that by the end of our strategy, when you get to that 97 payments earlier, this is everything is paid off free and clear. You're not holding this debt long term.
Okay.
Now, there are some folks who are high income earners. They just leave that home equity line of credit there for tax purposes so that they can continue to generate that tax income. The way this strategy is set up is we have it all paid off and you're not left with a big home equity line of credit when you go into retirement.
Thank you.
Thank you. Those are really good questions. Anything else? One more? Okay, awesome. Thank you so much for listening, guys. I really appreciate that.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you, Ron. What a wonderful knowledge that you share with us. So, hindi ko pala naipakilala yung sarili ko kanina. Medyo slide lang, sayin lang. So anyway, before natin ipakilala yung ating main speaker, I'd like to just give, medyo ano lang, icebreaker lang. Charot, kakanta po ako. Okay ba kayo doon?
Yes!
I'm gonna sing Henry, is that okay? Just kidding. I wish. Anyway guys, Ron, you are very known podcast and a mortgage broker in Saskatchewan. I'm so glad that, you know, you communicate with me and you're very open to, you know, sharing your ideas and your thoughts with us. So technically, this is a Filipino community that we would like to, you know, to get in touch with you. So hopefully everyone, if you are looking for a brokerage or mortgage associate, feel free to contact Ron. So thank you so much.
Or Justine,
yes. If you want a Filipino, Justine is also here. I'll give her an introduction later on. It's a separate introduction. Yeah, I know. Bukod doon, I would like to acknowledge too the presence of two realtors in Saskatchewan. So one is Canadian and one is Filipino. So if you don't mind standing up and, you know, just saying hi to everyone, I'll start with the Canadian first. And a good-looking guy, his name is Henry Friesen. So Henry, where are you from? Teesdale, right. He's from Teesdale. So if anyone from the crowd is from Teesdale, feel free to contact Henry. He's very nice. How would you mind if I ask, like your portfolio into the real estate? Oh my God, 24 units, guys. Who's excited to have 24 units? Task of mine. O, diba? 24 units. Thank you so much, Henry. And hopefully, everybody would be able, you know, to touch base with you or, you know, connect. That would be lovely. He is also a member of the REITs, Real Estate Investment Group in Saskatoon. So I'd like to introduce to you that group. There's quite a few people. Filipino, like maybe less than 10, right, Justine? Less than 10. We would love to have some new faces po doon na mga Filipino. Anyway, one more person that's also a realtor. He's from St. Brew, right?
Yeah,
I'm from St. Brew. He's from St. Brew. Very young realtor. His name is Kim Aquino. So Kim, how long have you been a realtor, if you don't mind me asking? Yes. Thank you so much. So another one that I'd like to acknowledge is also an investor from Calgary. Drove all the way from Alberta to here just to attend and meet our speaker. Where are you, Kuya? Where's the one from Calgary? Ayun. Si Kuya Say. Kuya. Seb. Apo. Amusta po ang biyahe?
All good.
That's good. So, Kuya, do you have properties in Calgary too, or you're planning to acquire more?
I'm planning to acquire more even in Saskatoon.
Wow. See? He's planning to acquire more in Saskatoon. So, you know who to contact. I'll introduce another one. She's a good friend of mine and very special to me because she's helping me achieve lots of rental properties. Sinabing secret. So that's my secret. So I'm just gonna give you a brief introduction. So the other day, I am able to acquire my fourth rental property in Saskatchewan. So it's a secret po. I don't share it yet. But sinabi mo na ngayon kasi syempre nasa workshop tayo. And I'd like to inspire all of you to, like, I just started siguro 5 years ago with rental investing. And I'm so glad that I did it and I listened to my siblings and my brother-in-law tsaka kay Sir Tom na naging mentor ko. So right now I'm working on to my fifth rental property, hopefully in Saskatoon because mine are all in Humboldt. So I'm moving to Saskatoon next month. So hopefully I'll be able to connect with everyone that's here. So yun po. Naputol ako. I'd like to introduce my good friend Justine Rafael. She's mortgage associate. Stand up, babe. You're so pretty. She's so pretty, very young. So how long have you been a mortgage associate, my dear?
My second year.
You're on into your second year.
And I approved her on
the fourth
one yesterday.
So sinabi niya, she's the one to look after kapag gusto niyo mag-approve. Very, ano siya?
And Ron,
yeah. Those two. Real estate is all about networking, making friends, and making wealth, right? So I'm so excited dahil I'm into real estate investing. This opens my mind and my eye that there's so much to offer with real estate. I quit my full-time job, and I'm happy now. I'm having financial freedom. Time freedom for with my family and the kids. I think that's the most important part, yung time spent with family.
Pautang.
Mamaya. I'm just joking. Harry's just asking to, he wanted to use other people's money in Tagalog. That's what he says. So you would understand. No, I'm just kidding. Anyway, another one that I would like to introduce, she is technically an idol too. She is from Regina. She is a nurse by profession. And we just met into the, introduced by the speaker himself. And instantly we just had a connection because she's into real estate too. It's our first time to meet today. And I'm so excited she's having upscale real estate investing in or investment in Regina.
and she's making her name into the Saskatchewan real estate market. I'd like to introduce you guys, Miss Preets. Preets, her name is Preets. She's a nurse. So, did you quit your nursing profession yet?
No, I haven't quit.
You did?
No.
You still have it, right? No. But you're into like part-time real estate investing.
I just wanted to switch shifts with
Kate. Oh, okay. I see. So she has so many knowledge too, wisdom with real estate. And if you guys would like to connect sa mga Tiga Regina area, look for Preets. She's open to partnership as well. So yun lang. Ano ba? Before ako mag-start sa ating new, sa ating main speaker for today. Any question po? So do you want to know and do you want to meet our speaker?
Yes.
Yes. He's the main event, the main man. Okay, I'd like to just give you a short background of this person, hey? So our speaker is a graduate of mechanical engineering. I should have done that earlier. He's a graduate of mechanical engineering from Bulacan State University in the Philippines. He worked in the Middle East for 14 years, 8 years in Saudi Arabia and 6 years in Dubai. He is married to G. Where's Ate G? Hi, Ate G. And they have 3 kids. He migrated into Canada in 2011. So technically, he's here for like 13 years, right, Pop? He worked as a laborer, pandesal delivery boy for the first 2 years in Canada. Imagine, pandesal boy in Canada for the first 2 years. Pandesal is bread. He's selling bread. Ron or Henry. I'm translating it into English. Pandesal boy. So, pandesal boy, it's like...
Morning bread.
But I mean, he started from the scratch. So, just the big background. He got the professional engineer license in Ontario in 2020 and started real estate investing at the last quarter of 2020. So technically 4 years, right, Pop? 4 years into real estate investing. He was able to quit 9-to-5 job in 2021 and own over 100 units of rental portfolio. Imagine, how can I do that? With properties located in Ontario and Nova Scotia.
Oh my God, idol, right?
Idol, 100 properties. Oh my God, in how long?
4 years.
He organized Filipino construction professionals of Ontario, known as PhilConPro, a group of Filipino professionals, mostly engineers, which aim to help new immigrants integrate into Canadian labor market. And he is a co-founder of the Canadian Pinoy Real Estate Investors, or CAPRE, with the goal of helping Filipino Canadians invest in real estate to improve their lives. So technically, this is just one way of his, you know, returning the favor that the Lord is giving to his family. So this is technically a free seminar that is given to the kababayans. So palakpakan po natin si Sir Tom sa ganyang ginawa nito. Hindi pa yan. That's not yet over. He was able to build a company called T4G Properties Incorporated. So this is a wholesaling business aiming to guide investors acquire multifamily rental properties at a great price and hassle-free process. He continuously hustling by acquiring service businesses, currently own Pasada, supplier of windows, doors, blinds, and shutters. He is currently negotiating the purchase of 2 more companies, fire protection and plumbing companies. So, oh my gosh, like that's a whole bunch of portfolio from this man. And I'm so glad that I was able to connect to this person. He is kababayan from Bulacan. So I'm also from Bulacan. So I'm so glad that we were able to connect. Even he's from Ontario. So I just messaged him on Facebook. My brother-in-law initiated, and then that's it. And he just told me, if you wanted to know more about real estate investing, let's conduct a workshop, and you do the honor to, you know, to find the attendees, and we'll do it. And without second thought, I said yes, because I know from the start that I'll be able to learn a lot from this man. So let's give him a round of applause, Mr. Tom De La Cruz. Ready nyo na po yung notes. Make sure you have your notes, because he's gonna be talking nonstop. And if you have questions later on, you'll be able to ask whatever. There's gonna be Q&A portion, and oh my gosh, I need to know the secret. I need to know the secret, Mr. Tom, to acquire lots of properties.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Celine, for the wonderful introduction. Please give her a round of applause for organizing this. And also for the support from Albert and Justin and Francis and my cousins on that table, Angie and Marlon. Thank you so much. And all my friends at the back, my colleagues from Dubai. So, yeah. Good afternoon. So, ready for the learning?
Yeah.
All right. So what I will do, I think I was given 1 hour. So I will just, oh, by the way, again, Ron, wonderful presentation. So I hope we learn something about cash dumping. It's a great strategy, cash dumping. So reach out to Ron if you need more information. And Henry, thanks for coming into this event. Appreciate it. So let's start about the real estate thing, right? So who are the mortgage brokers here? Ron and Justin? Realtors?
Kim
and Henry? All right. And insurance brokers? Insurance agents? No?
Right here.
Oh, there you go. So, let's start rolling. Thank you for coming again. So I will just want to share my journey about real estate, right? So I don't know if all of you has the gadget called Google or Alexa. Who has Alexa at home? No one has Alexa? Alexa, turn off the light, please. Yeah. You don't have that? There you go. What about Google? There you go. For me, what I use is Siri. S-I-R-I, right? That's the principle that I'm using. But it is an acronym. Letter S, starts with S, is show up. Right? You come here, you want to learn, you show up. Some people say, I cannot go to that event because I don't have property yet, I know nothing, I don't have a job. The problem here is they don't want to show up. That's the goal of networking, right? You come here, you should be the dumbest person in the room, right? You should be the sponge. You have to absorb all the knowledge that you can get from this event. So make sure, if you want to go to an event, make sure you will be the dumbest person. That's how you learn, right? And by attending this, by showing up, you will learn so many things, like one Ron has presented to us, right? Actually, cash dumping is not familiar with me. So now, I learned from that presentation too. I'm still learning. I cannot say I'm an expert. I'm still learning, right? So by showing up, you learn those things. By showing up, you're connecting with different people. Insurance agent, mortgage broker, and realtor, right? So that just by showing up. So I suggest show up and be present, right? Absorb the knowledge that you will receive from today. Some people say, Tom, we are 4 hours away from the venue. It's just an excuse. We are building an excuse to our mind, saying, I don't want to do it. So we want to achieve something, but we are doing the same thing over and over again. Right? That's what we call insanity. We want different result, but we are doing the same thing over and over again. We wake up in the morning, we go to work, 9 to 5, we go home, we sleep, and the next day we do it again. So it's called insanity. So if you want to change something, show up to this kind of events and learn from the people around you. Right? Getting it?
Yeah.
Are you ready to get blasted today? Or to get a sermon?
Right? Sermon.
Yeah. So, yeah, it came to my mind when I'm on the same shoes as you are. I'm into a mastermind. I paid hundreds and thousands of dollars of mentorship. In one event, the speaker or my mentor told me, or told us, the group, look to your right, look to your left, and introduce yourself. So I look to my left, there's a guy sitting here, and I said, hey John, my name is Tom, I'm from Canada, it's in Cleveland, Ohio. The event is in Cleveland, Ohio. So I told my seatmate, I said, my name is Tom, I have 50 rental units that time, I have 50 rental units from Canada. And he looked at me and said, my name is John, I have 2,000 rental units in Ohio. Right? So right away, I humbled myself. I thought, I'm on this level, but sitting beside me has 2,000 rental units. And I look at him, he's more handsome than me, but 2,000 units. So that means, right, you're being humble. You don't know what you don't know. You thought that you are already here. In reality, it's not. Right? So by showing up, I connected with him. How do you do the 2,000 rental unit? What did you do? What's the strategy? So I learned from that. So what is S?
Show up.
Letter I from Siri. Invest in yourself. Right? Who has mentors here? Richie has. Ron. Kim. No one? Justin. And Cindy. Yeah. That's the number one thing that I want to tell you. Get a mentor. When I started real estate investing, that was last quarter of 2020. So I paid $30,000 for a mentorship for 6 months. So after 6 months, your $30,000 is gone. And if you want to stay within that mentorship, you have to pay $2,500 every month. And I paid for 1 year, $2,500. So I got the mentor. Why do we need mentor? Because that mentor, he has 26 or 30 years of experience, and I'm just paying him $30,000 in return of that 30 years of experience. So I shortened my struggle. I learned the lessons, I learned the do's and don'ts of the business, of the real estate, by paying him $30,000 in return of the knowledge that I will get from him. You see the difference? Instead of, some people say, Tom, why you're so stupid? Why do you pay $30,000? You can find it in Google, in YouTube, in the social media, or in the books. Yeah, that's right. But why nobody's doing it? Right? It's really whatever the mentor told me is in YouTube. You can watch it. In Google, you can Google it, right? But why we are not doing it? Because we don't have accountability. My mentor told me at the beginning of our mentorship call, he said, okay, Tom, you have decided you pay $30,000. Okay, what do you want? That's the next question. What do you want? Right? So I told my mentor, okay, simple. I just want a nice house, a nice car, and money in my bank account. That's what I want. He said, that's not your goal. That's not a goal. I said, that's what I want. I want a nice house, a nice car, and money in my bank account. He said, that's not a goal. So I said, that's what I want. He said, no. A goal should be smart. If you heard that, S-M-A-R-T, SMART goal, specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound. Right? Specific means, okay, you want money, how much? So I said, okay, I just needed $3 million in my bank account in 3 years. So that's specific. I want $3 million in my bank account in 3 years. So that's the S on the SMART goal. Okay, what about the car? I said, I just want red Range Rover, RRR. Right? In 3 years. I needed Range Rover in 3 years. In first year, I accomplished that. Right? So about, this is what I'm saying. Mentors are great source of knowledge that can expedite your success. Right? Invest in yourself. Who have read books about real estate? There's a lot. Reading books also. I have, during my mentorship, the mentor asked me to read one book per week. So a total of 52 books in 1 year. That's a lot. But it gives so much knowledge in myself. So the mentor is telling you, Tom, this is what you have to do. This is where you should be, right? And at the same time, my mentor also told me, okay, what do you want else? He said, are you still working on your 9-to-5 job? As an engineer, I said, yes, but I don't have that much salary, right? I will, full disclosure, I'm getting 85,000 per year. That was 2020. So my mentor told me, how much do you want to quit your job? I said, I need to pay my mortgage, I need to pay my car insurance, I need to feed my family, I need to have money for shopping. All in all, $5,000. I just needed $5,000 to quit the job. I think most of you are just needing like that, $5,000 or not enough?
Per month.
Per month.
Yes.
If you wanna see that, go home tonight, itemize everything, put it in writing, and check how much do you need to quit your job. So that's what we need, $5,000 in 1 month. Mortgage, insurance, car, food, and everything, allowances, $5,000. And he told me, do you have money? I said, I don't have. And he said, do you have credit card? I said, I have. How much is the limit? I said, $40,000. Okay, so you have $40,000 in your credit card, quit your job. Who will do that? $40,000 in credit card, but you don't have money. And he asks you to quit the job. So what I did is what we call obedience. I just closed my eyes and I quit the job. I said, how can I feed my family? You have $40,000. He said, you needed only $5,000 per month. So in 8 months, your family can survive with your credit card alone. And by the time when you quit your job, you have all the time to do what you want. Right? I quit my job. But with the knowledge that I got from my mentor, the first month after quitting my job, I earned $75,000. By wholesaling real estate. I can teach you wholesaling later on. That's what my So this is what I'm saying. Mentorship, invest in yourself. Some people say, when we are discussing with Celine, how much is the fee? She said $50. Why is it so cheap? I'm paying $30,000, I'm sharing it for free, and people who are asked to pay $50, they don't want to pay $50. So that means your value is below $50 only, right? I'm paying $30,000, so that means my value is more than $30,000.
That's why you're there.
That's why you're there. Yeah. So some people think about money, about the price, but they're not thinking of the value. Right? Price versus value. That time, before the $30,000, I joined a mastermind also, mentorship. I'm paying $59 per month. $59 per month. So cheap. So I said, how can I pay $59 per month? So easy fix. I went to Value Village or thrift store, right? I get a component, I buy a component there for $50, bring it home, put it in marketplace, sold it for $150. So I got $100 in 2 hours time, I sold the component, I paid my mentorship fee, easy. So why are we not doing those? Right? It's pretty easy. Go to Value Village, get something, post it in marketplace, sell it. You earn money, you pay for the mentorship. Getting it?
Yeah.
Okay, so S, what is I?
Invest
in yourself. Letter R of Siri, reach out. Right? Reach out. So if you, some people say, Tom, I don't know how to buy properties. I don't know how to find it. How to find it, how to find it. That's why you have to reach out. Justin is here, Ron is here. Reach out to them. Reach out to those people who are doing what you want. Same thing as my mentor. I want to be like my mentor because he's 35 years old. He's traveling around the world. He doesn't have job, he has Lamborghini, he has nice house. I said, I want to be like you. So I reach out to him. Same thing here. Reach out to people who you wanted to do what they are doing. Right? Not to your neighbor, not to your father, not to your family, not to your brothers and sisters, because they don't do what you want to do. It's like you want to have a six-pack abs, but you're asking a 400-pound person how to get six-pack up. It doesn't make sense, right? If you want six-pack up, why do you ask the heavyweight person to get a six-pack? And if you want to learn about financial strategies, why do you ask a financial advisor who is working on his 9-to-5 job? Doesn't make sense. Why do you ask him if he's still on his job? Ask him if he has quit the job and he has investment. So financial advisor should have different strategies, different investments. Right? Reach out to the right person. Getting it?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Last I of Siri. Increase your income. Who has 9-to-5 job here? There you go. Majority. It's okay. Who says 9-to-5 job is not okay? It's okay. But that's only one source of income. We call it verticals. One source of income is one vertical. So if you want to have more money, you have to have more verticals. One rental income, or one 9-to-5 job, rental properties, Airbnb, lending, whatever it is, you have to have more source of income. So increase your income. Some people say, no, Tom, I want to be a millionaire. Okay, what do you do? I save. So what do you do? How are you saving? Oh, I'm not drinking Tim Hortons anymore. So I'm saving $2 per day. Okay, that's nice. $2 per day. How much in 1 month? $60. How much in 1 year? $720. Are you going to be a millionaire with $720? No. Increase your income. Forget about $2 Tim Hortons. Buy it and increase your income. Right? Some people say, Tom, I have to go to Costco because it's cheaper. In Costco, it's 3 cents cheaper than Petro Canada, which is close here. I better go to Costco. Waited for 3 hours on the line to get 3 cents discount. Doesn't make sense. You're earning, say, $20 per hour in your job. Why do you have to go to Costco, wait for 3 hours to save 3 cents of gasoline? Right? Increase your income. Forget about those expenses. Buy it. Just increase your income. Getting it? I'm also one of those people. Even my wife. Whenever we got flyers on the mail, oh, Walmart, 50 cents off from Tide. Hey, cutting. Right? Cutting all those coupons. Oh, there is sale of tissue in Walmart and another soap in No Frills. Oh, we have to go here and here. You're wasting so much time. Instead of just buying it in one place, increase your income. Got it?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's simple, right? Increase your income. So Siri, what's Siri?
Show up.
Invest in yourself. Reach out. Increase your income. Right? Some of my friends say, Tom, I'm browsing in Amazon. I can get a great book that you recommended. Rich Dad, Poor Dad book. I'm searching in Amazon. For 3 hours, he's searching in Amazon to find a better deal. Instead of paying $10, Tom, I got a good deal here for $8.95. Yes, I'm winning. Not. You wasted 3 hours of your time for $1 savings of a book. Right? We're guilty. We're guilty, right?
Yeah.
Miss Coupon, Justin Coupon. I know, but again, look at the big picture. Don't look at $50 item, $100 item. That's what we discussed with my wife. Whenever we are buying something at the grocery store, if it is just $100, buy it. Just buy it. You just have to increase your income. So that's what we do. Get a rental property, increase your income. Buy a business, increase your income. Don't worry about $100. That's what my mentor told me. My mentor told me, Tom, if you are not earning $100,000 net per month, you're in the wrong place. $100,000 per month, you're in the wrong place. So you have to think big to achieve your goals. If you want $1 million, don't talk to people talking about $10, $2, Starbucks. Forget about them. Move away from them. Change your mindset. If you want $1 million in your bank account, do something. Because if you are earning $100,000 per year in your 9-to-5 job, how can you reach $1 million? It will take you 10 years to get $1 million. If you're not spending something, right? How can you get $1 million if you're earning $100,000 per year with your salary alone? It will take forever. So increase your income. Guilty?
Yes.
Guilty. Okay, sorry. I'm also like that before. Okay, so I will give some strategies now. So Siri is done. Hope you will think about Siri all the time. Hey Siri, turn on the light, please. Siri, Siri, Siri. Okay, so giving you some strategies now. Ron has given us one strategy, right? The cash damming. Are you ready for strategies? How to buy properties?
Yes.
Okay. Who has primary residence? Almost everyone, right? So as what Ron has said, you can buy rental properties using the equity of your house. From his example, he said you buy a house for $500,000, and the value appreciated to $800,000, that's what Ron has presented earlier. So if you go to the bank, you can tell bank, or go to Justin and Ron. Hey Justin, my house which I bought for $500,000, now is $800,000. Can I get the equity? Equity is called the difference between the current mortgage and the value, the market value of your house, right? So that's what we call equity. In order to buy a rental property, you can get that equity and buy a rental property, right? In this scenario that he presented earlier, the value of the house is $800,000. You have a mortgage of $500,000. So if you go to the bank or mortgage broker, they will give you 80% of the value of your house. Usually 80%, some 75%, depending on your score and different circumstances. So if your house is valued at $800,000, you have a mortgage of $500,000, the bank will give you 80% of the value of your house. Meaning if you have $800,000, 80% of that is 640, and then they will pay the 500,000 that you owe. That means you have 140,000 ready to deploy by a rental property. So use your equity of your house. Don't pay it quick. It's counterproductive. Don't pay the house quick. I will pay Tom every week so that I can finish paying my mortgage, so that when I retire, I don't have mortgage anymore. It's wrong. Yeah, even if you paid your house when you retire, remember you have to pay property tax, you have to pay insurance, you have to pay renovation costs if there are some repairs. Where are you going to get those money if you don't have any job already? Right? It's counterproductive. Make use of other people's money, which is the bank's money that you borrowed, the 140, buy a rental property. Right? Getting it? That's one. There are three main ways you can get money from your house, the equity of your house. One is the HELOC that we explained, home equity line of credit. Another one is refinance. You refinance the property. And another one is the second mortgage. You can get that second mortgage, go to the bank, get that second mortgage, and buy a rental property. Those are the three main ways to get rental property. You getting it?
Yes.
Okay? So Tom, I don't have a house. How can I invest? There are so many ways. It's just that we don't know what we don't know. Again, letter R, reach out. How can I buy property if I don't have primary residence? We have done that so many times, different strategies. One example is in Ontario, specifically in Northern Ontario, I found a duplex worth 200,000, right? 200,000 for a duplex. So I approached the bank. I said, Mr. Bank, I want to buy this duplex. What do I need to do? Again, reach out. And the bank says, you have to have 20% down payment. 20% of 200,000, 40,000. And do you have 40,000? I said, my wife has RRSP. I have RRSP. I have insurance. I have life insurance here. We have some savings here. So the bank look at those numbers in papers, right? Just in papers. So we show that we have some RRSP here, some cash here, so it totals 40,000. And the bank says, okay, you have 40,000, I will lend you the 160,000, I will approve you for a mortgage, you can buy that duplex. 1 week before closing, right, I called all the banks, TD, Scotia, BMO, RBC, I said, I needed unsecured line of credit. Unsecured means you don't have any collateral, it's just your credit score, right? I call all the banks 1 week before closing, and the first bank who responded is Scotia Bank. Tom, I can give you 30,000, right? I take the 30,000, give it to my lawyer, we close the deal. It didn't reflect it on, there's the risk, there's a catch. If they do a last minute check, you're screwed. Right? Last minute check before closing, usually a day before closing, they will check everything about you. If circumstances are still the same, at that time they didn't do it. So I was managed to buy a property without my own money. The bank gave me the 160 and the 40,000 from different banks, unsecured line of credit. So what's the reason that you cannot buy a property without your own house, without your own money? That's just one strategy, right? Unsecured line of credit. Again, OPM, other people's money. I didn't use my money, we didn't use our savings, we didn't use our RRSP, unsecured line of credit. Getting it?
How much was your interest?
Sorry?
For that,
it's around 7%. And the property, the duplex, is cash flowing like $300. So it covers the mortgage, it covers the utilities, the insurance tax, and I still have cash flow after all the payoff. So make sure when you buy a property, you run the numbers and make sure it has a cash flow that covers the mortgage and the HELOC and the line of credit. So that's one strategy, right? Buying a property without your own money. Another one is buying a property with JV partners, joint venture partners, right? If you don't have money, let's say you don't have money, and Seth has money, I will approach Seth. Seth, let's buy a property together, and you will be the money partner, I will be the working partner. I will manage the property, Seth will put the down payment. We buy the property together, we both are entitled, and we close the deal. Again, other people's money, it's Seth's money, but I got a property. Right? Getting it? Another one is wholesaling. Have you heard wholesaling before? Yeah? Wholesaling is a strategy in real estate wherein I will buy a property, not buy, I will put the property under contract, right? For example, Justin, I want to buy your house for $200,000. Sign on this document, agreement of purchase and sale. So Justin signed on this agreement that she is selling me her house for $200,000, closing on this day, these are the conditions. And then when she signed the document, I turn around, sell it. Or Carol, you want a house for $210,000. She signed it for $200,000, I sold it for $210,000. It's $10,000 in less than 1 hour work. On my first year, I did 18 deals. 18 of that kind of transaction. I earned $220,000 in the first year. Just by doing that. Hey, you wanna sell your house? Hey, you wanna buy a house? There you go. You have to make sure that you will close the deal. Something like that. Wholesaling, that's what wholesaling is. 2022, I closed 52 deals. Just doing that. Like one deal every week. For 1 year, I got 52 deals of wholesaling real estate. It netted me, not net, it's gross around 600,000. Just doing that. Talking to seller, talking to a buyer, close the deal. That's wholesaling. Yes?
Are these private deals? Do you reach out to people who listed their property in MLS, or do you?
Both.
How do you find?
Both. Okay, we'll take the Q&A question. Yeah, that's the right question, right? How do I get the deals? How do I find the deals and how do I find the buyer, right? So again, it's the networking, the connection. If I want to buy a property, for example, here in Saskatoon, I live in Ontario, I want to buy in Saskatoon. What I will do, I will reach out to all realtors here, to all mortgage broker here, to all in the insurance agent here. Hey, I want to buy a property in Saskatoon. Right? So I reach out to them, I call them. This is my criteria. I want multifamily, minimum duplex, maximum 10-plex. If you saw something that's being listed or someone, if you know someone who's selling the property, give it to me, give me the details, phone number and name, and I'm done. If I close the deal, I'll give you $2,500. But that's what I do. We call it bird dog. Bird dogs are those people who will tell you, hey Tom, Peter is selling his house. Here is his name, here is phone number, get in touch with him. As soon as I close the deal, I will give him $2,500. So every time, almost during my first year of investing, I'm getting calls from them. Hey Tom, somebody's selling here. Don't forget my $2,500. I said, that's okay. I'm getting $10,000 in one deal. What is $2,500, right? So that's easy. If you don't have real estate, if you don't have house, if you don't have job, that's a great way to earn money. How many strategies do you have now? Three? You got three?
Yeah.
Another way to earn money is, we call it arbitrage. Arbitrage is using other people's assets or something. Like for example, Carol has a property which is for rent. Carol, I want to rent your property for $3,000. So Carol said, okay, I will rent it out to you for $3,000. And then when I turn my back, who want to rent a house for $3,500? So I'm renting the property that I rented from her to somebody, and I'm earning $500 every month doing nothing. So, what? Okay.
So who's going to pay the capital gains then? When you the scenario that you gave earlier. If, for example, you got property for $200,000, you sold it to her for $10,000, who's going to pay the capital gains then?
It's not capital gains. I don't have capital gains because I didn't close the deal. I didn't put the property under my name. I'm selling the contract, not the property.
So who's take the original?
She will be the one paying because she sold the property to her. I'm just the middleman. So I'm just selling the contract. It didn't put my name in any of the property, right? So that's how wholesaling is. If you don't have money, just put the contract and then sell the contract. You're not selling the house, just the contract. So I don't have capital gains. I do have to pay tax on the gain, the $10,000. So two ways. If I'm using my name to buy Justin's house, to put it under contract, I will be taxed as the regular income, 9-to-5 income. But if I use a corporation to buy her property, it's taxed differently, right? Personal tax has higher tax bracket than a corporation tax. So I put up a corporation, I use it, that's what Celine has presented earlier. I put up a corporation called T4G, and I use it for wholesaling so that the tax is minimal. All right? How many strategies for? Another one. Have you heard about getting property for free? As in free? No? Nova Scotia. Okay, I'll tell you what did I do. I got that fourplex for free. Fourplex. So when I quit my job, I have all the time to do. I whenever I wake up, I just go to the internet, realtor.ca or Self Emirates. So I saw four listings in Nova Scotia. Four properties for sale. Each one of them is a fourplex. Fourplex, 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 fourplex. Four of them. I found out that those fourplexes owned by one person. It's in MLS with a realtor. So I reached out to the realtor. I said, I want to buy those four properties in one shot. I will buy them all. It's listed as $325,000 per unit, per fourplex, $325,000. So I told the agent, I will buy them all, but not at your price, because I'm buying everything in one shot. You're just talking to one person, it's me. So instead of buying it at $325,000 each, I said I can offer you $270,000 each. The seller agreed, $270,000 each. We put the property under contract. Okay, 270 here, 270 here, 270 here, 270,000 here. We signed the contract. And then, as soon as he signed the contract, I called my friends. Hey, buddy, do you want a fourplex for 290? And he said, oh, that's a good deal. Okay, I'll buy it. One. Hey, buddy, you want a fourplex for 290? And he said, oh, that's a good deal. I will buy it. Two down. Hey, buddy, you want a fourplex for 290? Oh, that's a good deal. I'll buy it. Three down. I bought it for 270. I sold it for 290. How much did I gain? 60,000, right? 20, 20, 20. So I'm potentially earning 60,000 on those deals. So there is one more fourplex. I go to the bank, Mr. Bank, I want to keep that fourplex. And the bank says, okay, do you have money for down payment? And I say, how much is the down payment? 20% of 270. How much is it? 54,000. How much do I have? 20, 20, 20. I got 60,000. Mr. Bank, I have 60,000. Fourplex is yours. How cool? Right? Free house, free fourplex. It's just that you have to know what you're doing. And how do I learn it? Mentorship. I invest in myself. Cool?
Yeah.
You want more?
Yes.
I think that's enough.
That's good for $50, eh?
Huh?
That's good for $50.
I told you, $50. You came here for $50, right? How much? This is what I want you to do. As soon as you leave this room, make sure you implement the stuff that you have learned today. And before we go to question and answer, this is what my mentor told me. Whenever I ask question from him or to him, he said, Tom, if you want to ask a question, make sure you do the answer. Again, if you want to ask me a question, make sure you do the answer. If I say, Mr. Mentor, how can I learn wholesaling? Make sure you do the wholesaling. It's just not just to ask questions. If you want to learn something, make sure you do it.
No question.
No, because you don't want to do anything. No question. Okay, just
bird.
Okay, bird. See? Now you're asking one more strategy. I give you one example of bird. Again, OPM, other people's money. BIR is an acronym for buy, renovate, rent, refinance, and repeat. BRRRR, right? It's a strategy in real estate. You buy a house, you renovate a house, you rent it out, refinance, and repeat. This is one example. I found a triplex. Actually, it's not in MLS. It's in Facebook group. I joined different Facebook group. And one guy posted, I'm tired of being a landlord. I'm selling my triplex and a fourplex. So I reached out to the guy. I said, I want to buy your property. So he said, I have a triplex, Tom. I want to sell it for 160. So I said, okay, give me the address. So he gave me the address. I have a software called GU Warehouse in Ontario. I don't know if you're using it here. GU Warehouse, if I type the address, it will show me who's the owner, how much did they bought it, when did they bought it, who are the previous owners. I'm paying $4,000 every year for that software. I just type the name or the address, and I got all the details. So I said, okay, I'll buy your triplex for 160 with the conditions of inspection and financing. Only two, inspection and financing. So I sent an inspector, so he agreed. First, I agreed for 160. I signed the dotted line, 160. I will buy your house, triplex for 160. And then I sent an inspector after he signed the agreement. And then the inspector said, Tom, you don't want to buy it. I said, why? Three drug addicts in each unit, nasty roofing, damaged windows, doors are crappy. Everything is crappy. So I get back to the seller. Hey, Mr. Seller, I cannot pay you 160. Three drug addicts, non-paying tenants, windows are damaged, roof are damaged. I said, I can only pay you $60,000. From 160 to 60. And he is a motivated seller. So he said, okay, take it. I don't want the property because he cannot collect the rent from the three drug addicts. Right? So he can, and they're destroying the property. So I got it for 60,000 under contract. And that time, again, I don't have money, But I have strategy. So I call my friend, hey, buddy, do you have 60,000 there? Can I borrow 60,000 and I will pay you 10% interest for that 60,000, 10% annual. So that means if I borrow 60,000, I will pay him 6,000 for 1 year by just borrowing his money. So I got 60,000 from my friend. I closed the deal, right? So I got the property under my name for 60K. Again, it's not my money, it's my friend, but I'm paying interest on that. And then there you go. As soon as I acquire it, there are like 100,000 worth of renovation. So I bought the property, first letter on verb, buy, right? B-R-R-R-R, I got buy for 60K, and then the renovation is costing me like 100K renovation because it's crappy. So again, I called my friend, hey buddy, you have 100,000, can I borrow? I pay you 10%, I'll give you after 1 year. And that friend of mine, he has 100,000 because he just refinanced his property. I got 100,000, I renovated the property. The tenants are still there. They're not paying, right? But I renovated the property. So buy, renovated, and then there are tenants who are not paying. I said, there are two ways here. If you want diplomatic or you want by force. Meaning diplomatic, hey, you're not paying your rent, I need the property, you have to leave. Or I file a case with landlord-tenant board to get you evicted, right? One of them, they said, Tom, okay, you're a gentleman, I will leave. One left, two more down, right? Two more drug addicts there. So one has left by its own, renovated the unit, put a new tenant. The second one, while we were in Nova Scotia with that fourplex that I got for free, my property manager in that location, in Timmins, where I bought the triplex, he called us, he said, Tom, there is a police in your property. On that triplex, on those three drug addicts, one drug addict died in your property. He died. I said, what happened? The property manager said, the daughter called the dad, which is the drug addict. He called the dad on Tuesday, he didn't answer. Oh, she called the dad on Tuesday, he didn't answer. She called the dad on Wednesday, no answer. Thursday, no answer. So the daughter called the Timmins police and she said, can you get a check on my dad on that property, on this address? So the police went in, they knocked on the door, no one is opening. They pushed the air conditioning in and they saw a decomposing body. Nasty. Right, it's dead. So what did I do? I renovated the property. It's good that it was caused by overdose. There's no crime happened because if there's a crime, you have to disclose it if you want to sell it. He died through overdose based on the police investigation. Two down. I'm not happy that he died. I'm happy that I will replace a new tenant. So I renovated it, and then I put a new tenant. The third drug addict, unfortunately, is still there until today. Yeah, so that's part of real estate. It's not always roses and violet, right? Now he's paying. Yeah, the third one is paying. So this is the bird that I'm saying. I bought the property for 60K, I renovated for 100K, so that means I'm all in 160,000, right? And when I renovated that property, I put the new roof, new windows, new doors, I went to the bank, hey bank, I have a fully renovated triplex here. Can I get the refinance? Can I get the refinance? And the bank says, okay, it's worth 250,000 because you renovated. So the value of that property is 250,000. So the banks will give me 80%. Usually, again, 80% of the value, 80% of 250 is 200K. So the bank gave me 200K, and I paid the 60K, I paid the 100K, I have 40,000 in my pocket, and I have a fully renovated property that I own until now. Other people's money. That's where I refinance it, and now I'm repeating it. BRRRR. It's fun. It's fun.
$50 expired.
So yeah, that's what I'm saying, right? It's not always win. There are losses. Real estate, to be honest, real estate is simple. Very simple. But it's not easy. It's difficult, it's hard, it's tough. But it's simple. Right? Getting it?
Yes.
I think that's enough. Let's go to Q&A now, if you have questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So how do you run the numbers? You say that the deal is, that you're getting a good deal out of the property.
Yeah, so we have, during my mentorship, we got the spreadsheet, we call it an Excel file, pretty straightforward Excel. We run the numbers. This is the income, this is the expenses, this is the mortgage, this is the property manager cost, and this is the net. So that time at 3.5% interest rate, if I'm getting $100 minimum per unit, so if I buy a triplex, I should have minimum $300 net per month of cash flow, minimum. If it is less than 100 unit, I will not buy it. We bought the first duplex, we bought it for 250, a duplex, and we are cash flowing like $1,500 per month, net. After paying off the mortgage, after paying off the property manager, the insurance, the tax, the utilities, we have $1,500 per month.
So by percentage, how much will you
pay? Kung ang rent is 2,000, right? For example, the rent is 1,000, 1,000 for a duplex. 1,000, 1,000, so you have 2,000 and you get 200,000. 1%. Right?
But the interest rate is also
bad. Yeah, right now it's high. But the good thing on real estate is here. I have that property whose my tenant died, right? I lost a lot. But this is the thing that the old owner didn't see. He didn't see that, okay, the tenants are not paying. He's losing money every month because they are not paying. But the value of the house, for example, the tenants are paying 1,000 each, just for the sake of numbers. You have a triplex, three tenants, all non-paying, you're losing $3,000 per month. So in 1 year, you're losing $36,000. If they didn't pay at all, $36,000. But if that property appreciate by $50,000, which one do you like? Appreciation of $50,000 or losing $36,000?
$50,000.
There you go. Buy a property, keep it.
Out of curiosity, for that property, was it paid off or did he have mortgage on it?
I refinanced it and then I got another.
No, when you bought it from him, he was losing rent, right?
Yeah,
was
yeah.
Was it paid off?
Yeah, it is paid off. $60,000.
Steal.
Yeah. It's a steal. From 160, I bought it for 60. Because I negotiated it well, because I know what I'm doing. Right? I ran the numbers and I said, hey, your tenants are not paying, this has to be renovated. So I have the leverage. This is the thing, if we are buying distressed properties, we have the leverage versus the property which is renovated by a flipper. I better renovate it on my own, but I can negotiate at a lower price versus a fully renovated property wherein the flipper makes money. I better buy the old one or the crappy one and then do it. It's not what I'm doing. I have a contractor who can do that. Okay, Q&A. Yeah.
For wholesaling, do you need to have a license for that? Or
no, you don't need to. You don't need the license. That's why some of the realtors are mad at me because they said, you're getting my business. Instead of them listing the property, I'm getting the deal on my own privately, right? But I know what to do. I know how to do it. I know the procedures because I paid for it.
And you know the value. When you wholesale it, you know that there's potential. potential there that it's a win too for the buyer.
Yes. I put myself on the buyer's shoes that if I buy this one for 210, which I bought from Justin for 200, I know that if he bought it from me for 210, he still has cash flow. So I have to run the numbers again, make sure he is benefiting it. So it's a win-win. She sold the house, I get my 10,000, and he got a property, which is cash flowing.
It's a very practical question. So it doesn't need to be a licensed realtor to do that strategy?
No, you don't need to. You just have to have a good lawyer. Good lawyer. If that's what the saying goes like this, if you are not getting sued, you're not an investor yet. I got sued so many times. A lot. But I have a good lawyer who can defend me, who can protect my interest. Right? Questions? While it's free, tomorrow I will charge you 30,000 here.
How do you make sure, like when you do wholesale, how do you make sure the buyer don't go straight to the realtor? Like when you present the property.
Sorry, say it again.
How do you make sure the buyer of the property, when you're wholesaling, how do you make sure the buyer doesn't go straight to the realtor who sells the property?
Because I put it under contract, right? If it is in MLS, I make sure that it's under my name. The contract is under my name. If it is under my name, the seller cannot sell it to anyone. Otherwise, I will sue him. Right? It's a legal document, right? Hey, Mr. Seller, you put it under contract. You cannot sell it to anyone because it's under my name. And I have the due diligence period, let's say 10 days. I keep the property for 10 days. Sorry. Oh, sorry, Carol. Okay, good question about the corporation and personal name. This is what I mentioned to Justin while we were driving and to Albert. If you are buying properties today or tomorrow or next week or next month, put it under the corporation. Why? Two main reasons. If you want to buy a property, a rental property, put it under the corp. I have more than 22 corporations today, as of today.
I got four.
There you go. So, two main reasons why you put it in corporation. One is liability. If you buy the property under your name, the tenant sleep, hit his head on whatever it is, he will sue you because you're the owner. Versus, he will sue the corporation where there's nothing. There's no money on the corporation. That's one. And number two, the exit. If you want to sell that property in 5 years, if it is under your name, you will have capital gain tax, which will be put on top of your income if you're still working by that time. So you have capital gain plus the income, you will be on the highest tax bracket. CRA will be happy with that. Right? So that's the two main reasons why you need to put it under the corporation. Did it answer the question? It's my mistake. I'm stupid because I bought four properties under our name before. It should be day one corporation. It is, but if you are aggressively buying, right? If you have a property under corporation now, if you want to buy another one tomorrow, there is a history of your corporation that it will be easily approved because you already have one. Yeah. It's still the same. I think Ron will agree that still they have to look. The lender will still have to look at your personal circumstances. Right? You will still be the guarantor, right? Guarantee, guarantor on that deal. Yeah, still there.
Yeah.
all BC lenders don't do whole corporations, so just a little bit more limited.
Yeah.
From a liability standpoint, also secondary.
What requirements are requirements?
Yeah, first of all, guarantee your credit, your income.
You have to pay like $50.
Yes, that's
correct. So, what's the best strategy for a guy like me that has a primary residence and then want to get into rent?
That's what Ron has mentioned earlier, right? If you have a property which is equity, take that equity and buy a property. Don't use your money as much as possible. Investing is more on OPM, other people's money. Right? Make sure, because you have cash in your pocket, in any case of emergency, you can pull it out. So make sure you use the equity of your house. That's what I recommend, that's what I suggest, because that's what I'm doing right now, and it works.
And is that possible, like Ron, what you're explaining, is that possible here in Saskatchewan or no?
It is possible. There, I think we're more limited here in Saskatchewan as far as lenders. In Ontario and BC, you have like over 60 lenders that will lend on a property. In Saskatchewan, I think 18 or 20. And so the amount of lenders that will lend in a holding corp is going to be limited, and so it's just determining what type of business you want to run. And so if you want to scale up like Hong, and if you want to do lots of track measures, you probably need to start corporations in order to build these properties. If your plan is to own 5 properties, that might change the conversation. So you as an investor will have to determine your overall profile, and if you want to own 100 properties, you're going to need to have corporations at some point. And would you agree with that, Hong?
Agreed. 100%, yeah. Put it under the corporation. Taxation purposes is cheaper. Like in Ontario, 12%. Versus the capital gains that was put on top of your income, you will be on the maybe 44% tax bracket.
I'm sure that was actually my question. It was just part of your question. What is your exit plan? Have you all those properties you have right now? Like, if you don't have an exit plan,
yeah, so the exit plan is to sell it. To sell it and go to the beach. That's the goal. Yeah. So that's the exit. The exit. One more last strategy, JV, which I've done so many times. JV partnership. If you don't have money, which I mentioned before, I had so much multiple properties under my belt using JV partnership. To give you an example, last December, I'm doing wholesaling still, right? I saw a property worth 900,000. It's a 9-unit apartment in Thunder Bay. You know Thunder Bay? Just near Manitoba, right? Border of Ontario and Manitoba. So I saw a property, 900K, 9-plex. So I reached out to the agent, it's in the MLS. I said, I want to buy that 9-plex. But 900, I can buy it for 670. From 900 to 670. Because the seller is motivated, he wanted to dispose the property. It's not I'm taking advantage. I said, I'm making profit out of this. So I locked it at 670. And then a friend of mine says, Tom, I have a friend in Vancouver who has money, wanted to invest in real estate in Ontario, but he doesn't have any person in Ontario. I said, great, I have a 9-unit apartment under contract. I can sell it to you for 710 from 670 to 710. And then you can have it. And he said, no, would you be able to join me on that venture? I said, okay, I will manage the property. You pay the property, I will manage it, split. So what did we do? We created a corporation, right? And I have the property under my contract. So I sold that property, I assigned that property to that corporation that we created from 670 to 710 So I earned 40,000 out of it. And that corporation who bought it, I'm also part of that because we created a corporation to buy that property. So at the front, I earned 40,000 and I'm part owner of that building as well because he paid 70,000, 710 cash, no mortgage, cash. So he has 710 paid to me, I got 40K, and I'm also a part owner of that building until now. And it's cash flowing. So many ways how to get properties. It's just, you have to reach out. And again, by showing up, letter S in Siri, by showing up, who do you think I will entertain? If somebody messaged me, Tom, my brother attended your seminar, I want to learn real estate, versus Fritz reaching out to me, Tom, I want to learn more real estate strategies, who will I help more? Fritz, because she showed up. Versus the person outsider, right? So by showing up, I know that she attended the event. I will stop what I'm doing just to help her. This is the benefit of showing up.
Sir, last question.
Yes, sir.
This is more of a personal question. Okay. So, sir, how am I going to leverage? Meron pa siya, I own a sole proprietor company. How am I going to make that as a leverage getting into renta? Or is there?
You have a plumbing company, yes, sole proprietorship. I suggest don't use that corporation to buy a property. If you want, there, this is what I've done too. So I have, for example, you have a plumbing company. Let's say, what's the name of the company?
The
Tuberos
Plumbing.
Tuberos? Tuberos. Tuberos. So say Tuberos Plumbing, and you want to buy a property, create a corporation.
Which is under process, yes.
Very good. So you have another corporation, which is, what do you call that? Tuberito?
Same thing.
Same, okay. So what happened is Tuberito doesn't have money, it's only a name of the corporation. This corporation can borrow funds from your plumbing company, say, hey, I want to borrow 50K. So that this Tubero property, Tubero business can lend money to this corporation, and this corporation can buy a property. So you have to have a paper trail. Because this Tubero will file tax, when this Tubero company of yours, plumbing company, will file a tax, it will be a loss because you lend money to another corporation. So it's kind of like a tax write-off because it's a loss. This one, it borrowed money from this company, so it's like a liability or something like lending, like this company lend money from here. So he has to pay when there is an income, he has to pay the Tuberos tax to make the accounting balance. Yeah. Again, corporation. Make sure it's under the corporation. No more questions? And nice meeting you all. I think that's it, Celine.
If we will be taking for one-on-one training with you, this will cost for 30,000.
Good question. Yeah.
500 per month.
Yeah, actually, there are some guys who approach me for mentorship. I might consider it, but at the moment, I'm just getting it for free. The reason being is when I started this real estate investing, my main purpose is to share my knowledge, right? At the beginning, I said, okay, I have this knowledge in my brain. If I die tomorrow, the one who will benefit my brain are just the worms. They will just eat my brain versus I can share it to people like you, which just you will be benefited.
$450.
Right?